5-minute pre-show before our 3-hour live safari, where we are trundling out and you get to hear a little bit of the behind the scenes and what we're doing and where we're going before we repeat it all again for you in the next few minutes. Now, this morning I have Jandre on camera with me, and I nearly threw Jandre off the car about 5 minutes ago. I'm sorry, Jandre. I don't quite know what happened. I had some kind of crossed nerve pathways in my brain. I was trying to warm up the brakes to stop them from squeaking, and somehow I just didn't quite fully think through what I was doing. Slammed on the brakes, and poor Jandre nearly landed in the passenger seat next to me. You're alive, Jandre? Yes. Good. That's good. I'm glad to hear it. You seem to be relatively alive. The camera hasn't started its gradual droop downwards, so I seem to be fine. Oh, there we go. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Jandre's gone, everybody. We lost Jandre. I did a bad thing. Fortunately, he doesn't seem to have sustained any major life-threatening injuries, which is a relief. Because then we would have had to wake up Brian, wouldn't we? Oh no, he's walking this morning. How can I make... Oh, goodness. And after all that, it didn't help. Shh, Jigger. It's okay. I'm groaning in protest. Had an interesting moment with Jigger yesterday. We had some very nice gentlemen in to patch up and fix the cars. And we are currently hosting a few special guests. So we all went down to breakfast at Voya Teller Lodge, having set the gentlemen up with the vehicles to fix them, put spare parts on. Obviously, we'd traced all the problems with the vehicles and all sorts of things. And when I got back, I came to have a look at how they were doing. And they said to me, yeah, we're all sorted and Wendy's looking good and we've put on this and we're busy with the transfer box and all is well. And I looked at the car that they were working on and it was Jigger. So Jigger is now sporting all of Wendy's new spare parts, for which I'm sure she is very grateful. She now has brand new spanking seals on her transfer box and all sorts of other fancy things that cars need. That's okay. It hasn't been a disaster. I did also, in a minor panic, try and contact Steph to let him know, only to realize he was at his son's nativity play. So then I felt even worse. Oops. But to be fair, they are smallish and green. Sorry, Bex, what was that about, Brent? I couldn't, for some reason, hear you. Ah. Okay. Rusty is apparently also having a little bit of a lion, much like my brain. Fortunately, Brent hasn't managed to throw VM off the back, he's just struggling with signal. Drat. I would have gone to last position of Karula, which I know Brent is planning on doing. But we're on our way to Cheetah Plains because today is National Cheetah Day. And that is where we have the best chance of seeing a cheetah. And it should be roundabout, not that they have any kind of regular routine, should be roundabout the time that we see them again. Oh, marvellous. It seems as though Rusty is functioning, in which case Brent and Viam will be starting the live safari for you this morning. I'm not quite sure where, I think Brent is still trying to follow up on the lions we heard. We'll see you shortly.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the dawn chorus. The birds are singing, the lions are roaring. This is Safari Live.
Ready. by.
Welcome, welcome to a glorious sunrise safari. My name is Brent. I've got VM on camera. Now, we heard lions roaring somewhere in this area. Unfortunately, the only tracks we've seen are crossing to the north into Buffalo's Hook. So we're just sitting quietly, taking in the beautiful bird sounds, the sunrise, and hoping we can hear a lion that's still on Juma. If we have no luck, we'll just go look for some leopards. But let's carry on. Remember, this is 100% live, so you're looking for lions with VM and myself. Maybe not quite at the same time. It's at 5 a.m. here in South Africa. And it's a little bit chilly this morning, 20 degrees Celsius, 72 Fahrenheit. And remember, you can also ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or the email address questions@wildearth.tv. So I'm going to do one last loop through this area. I've got the sinking sensation that the lions might have left us, but it means they will be back at some point. But that's fine. We'll go see if we can find Queen Karula. And the birds are very vocal on this beautiful, beautiful clear morning. Probably find it's going to be a scorcher. Well, I think we might get to 100 Fahrenheit today. Where are the kitty cats this morning? Oh. There we go. Hello, little diker. Oh, disappear. There you go. Oh, there he is. Female diker. Oh, did you hear that, Vim? Funny, I heard something up ahead. I'm not 100% sure what that was. It just caught us the tail end. It almost sounded like it could be a contact call of lions. VM says he heard contact calls behind his room, which is just over here. So maybe the lions got split during a hunt, and we'll find some of them. Whoopsie. Okay. Not seeing anything just yet. Very faint sound. Nope, no lions here. Now, someone from Buffalo's Hook is going to check the last position of the Nkuhumas. Okay, we're going to keep doing, or we're going to finish our last loop. If we get no sign of the lions here, we're going to go try and see if Karula and Hosana and Shangila are possibly still in the same spot they were yesterday. But while we do that, let's go say good morning to Jamie.
And a very good morning, official good morning to all of you, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari, where we are starting off with a very vocal troop of baboons, or at least they were vocal until a moment ago. What a lovely way to start off with the troop that we've actually seen regularly in this particular spot, which is just near the Mulwati drainage line, which is a big dried out river. I want to try and let you hear the sounds of the baboons. Unfortunately, it seems to be the ones behind me that are making the biggest racket. Ah, stop and have a jolly good leg scratch. That's nice. Here we go. Deep booming barks of the big male echoing behind us. Boom! Hello, guys. Very good morning to you. Sorry, everybody. Just letting one of the other vehicles on their way out come past. Cheers. Here we go. But yes, a very good morning and a welcome to the Sunrise Safari. And I completely concur with Brent. I think it is going to be another scorcher of a day. These baboons are about to disappear. Now, there we go. I'm glad that we watched them. Oh, no. There we go. Well done, Jandre. Let me rephrase that. These baboons may soonish disappear, but we have one in the tree for now, and I imagine the rest of the troop is going to be coming through behind me. But, oh, here we go. This is too good an opportunity to miss. Just hold on one second, because if we come off these baboons now, they're going to disappear. So let's have a look at the big male, and then I will do my proper good mornings and introductions in a moment. These are rare opportunities with baboon troops. They don't often stick around. Although this one is getting better. Yeah, big boy. Here is one of the big dominant males. Twice the size of a female. Twice the size and weight. And with canines to rival leopards and lions, they are a formidable, formidable force. I thought they were going to come dashing across the road. It's actually being a saunter. Look at that swagger that he's got happening there. There we go. Profound swelling underneath the tails of some of the individuals. Tells us that they're females, not quite in estrus, but they are sexually mature females, possibly about to come into estrus. It's one animal where, one of the primates, where colour plays an enormous role in letting them know about sexual receptiveness. On that note, a very good morning to all of you. My name is Jamie. Sorry, I didn't want to take my eyes off the baboons for a second. This morning I have Jandre on camera with me, bringing you the images of these baboons. And let's just go catch up with them ever so quickly. Don't forget that you are on a live safari from the middle of the Kruger National Park, the Greater Kruger National Park, and that you can, if you have any questions on these fantastic animals and others, you can send those through on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Let's try for one more view. I think that's going to be it. There we go, that's the last clear spot. And the entire troop moving through. If this is the troop that I'm thinking of, they actually only have one very large male, which is can be quite unusual in baboons. You often have more than one. In fact, you usually have more than one. They have a very interesting social hierarchy. Whoop. An elegant-ish descent. Good morning to Jamis and welcome. My first question of the morning. We want to know, why is it that baboons' tails look like they are broken like that? It's an interesting one. One of the theories put forward as to why baboons have those tails, because of course they're not quite as agile or as arboreal as monkeys. So their tails don't play such an enormous role in their climbing. One of the theories as to why they are propped up at that angle, is particularly for females, because in the first few months or the first few weeks of their babies' lives, they have to wander around on three legs with their babies clutched to their chests. Obviously, that's not very practical and not very safe. So as soon as the babies are old enough, they get onto their mom's backs and they ride piggyback style. But supposedly the tail acts as a nice little backrest for them. Interestingly enough, the angle of the tail, I don't know exactly, nobody really knows exactly why it is they've got that distinctive kink in the tail. I think it's just more practical, but it does start to droop. The older the baboon gets, and you can, I can't,
But researchers can actually roughly, if they can't get a view of the baboon's teeth, they can sort of roughly estimate baboon's ages by, once they're adult and once they're mature, by the droop of their tail. So there you go. It's an interesting aging factor in baboons, funnily enough. But as to why they are the shape that they are, I think it's residual tails. I think that they used to, probably would have found that they used to serve a, could have served a purpose like monkeys, in terms of acting almost like a fifth limb. The vervet monkeys are a particularly good example of that. You watch them, they use their tails all the time. Baboons are good at climbing, but not quite as good as vervet monkeys, and they do spend a lot more time on the ground. And that's one of the reasons why the males are as big as they are, to ensure that they can act as a very intimidating force, even for something like a leopard. I think, unfortunately, they've moved off. Michael, you wanted to know if baboon troops have set territories. Yes, they have set home ranges. They don't necessarily go about, as far as I know, they don't go about marking a territory, which is actually really the definition of a territory. Territory, a home range is the entire piece of land that an animal will utilize. A territory is something that the animal actively defends. So, for example, the Nkuhumas at the moment, they have a massive, massive home range that goes all the way to the Manyeleti, Simbambili, Arethusa. But up until relatively recently, their territory that they were regularly roaring in, regularly calling in, and I'm sorry, this actually does tie into baboons, in that there is a baby impala over there, and interestingly enough, it's a difficult one, but it might decide their mom's gonna move. There's a little one. Sorry, I'll get back to your question, Michael, in a second. Oh, little one, it's so wobbly. Well, this little one does actually have to be careful. And for the most part, baboons and impala get on very well. Impala are often found browsing beneath the trees that baboons are feeding up in, because they get to eat the fruits and the leaves and the debris that the baboons knock down. But it is not unheard of for a baboon to catch and kill an impala lamb. It does happen, and it is not a pretty sight at all. Not that a kill ever is, but baboons can be particularly brutal. And just keep going a little bit there, Jean-Dres. Oh, there's a bush in your way. Never mind. I saw another little antelope, but I don't know if I imagined it. If I'm hallucinating bushbuck this morning. I am. Or it's run away. It's more likely that it's run away. Possibly away from the... No, it's there. Can you see? There. I'll go forward ever so... I'm not hallucinating bushbuck. Oh, it's not a bushbuck, it is a baby inyala. It is a little baby sleepy inyala. Good morning, with your giant ears and big round brown eyes. So very doleful. Look that tiny. I mean, when inyala are very, very first born, their moms often leave them lying up in hidden places just like this. We've seen Karula take advantage of that relatively recently in the Mulwati. I wonder where your family is. Hello, little one. Are they just behind you, maybe? Or is this baby just a lot tinier than I think it is? Oh, good night. You're going back to sleep. Fair enough. It is still very early. Sorry, Michael. We were talking about baboons. They do have set home ranges, and they do have set routes that they'll walk. You'll notice these baboons tend... When we see them during the day, they tend to be moving north-south. Not very much movement east-west. Oh, goodness, there's actually still more of them coming. They're coming behind me. Hold on. Whoopsie. Trying not to scare them. No, Jigger, come. Stay started, please. They will also... Whoop. There we go. Oh, look. All the babies. There's one riding on Mom's back. See what I mean? Looks like it's fast asleep. Oh, no. It's awake. Morning. There's one hanging underneath Mom, clutching on for dear life. Oh, baboon babies are adorable. Surprised. Didn't realize there was another troop there. And they can actually have relatively fierce clashes with other baboon troops. They'll also almost always... Let's not get stuck in this thick sand. They also almost always have set roosting trees that they like to spend the night in. So, and you'll often find, because human beings, of course, like to build lodges around rivers, and rivers have big trees, you'll often find baboons roost every night around lodges on the river. Which is why you'll go to sleep, if you go to stay in one of those lodges, you'll go to sleep with the constant bah of the baboons at night. They're just that little bit too far in. Sorry, I'm trying. I don't think we'll have to take this as our last view. Unless there are more waiting in the woodwork, which I don't think so. Here they go. Now, a couple of relatively tiny babies. There's the piggybacking one. Cool. Very nice. Now, I think we might be done. Morning to Shamsun, as we attempt to wake Jigger up this morning. You want to know if there is a distinctive birthing season for baboons? You'll probably find that if you look at averages, there's a slight peak in the rainy season. There may even be a more pronounced peak in the rainy season, just because there's more food available, there's plenty of fruit. It's so much better for them than having babies in the dry season, but they do have babies all year round. Much like elephants, for example. Elephants don't have a strict breeding season. The females come into estrus individually. It's not determined by any set time of year, as it is with the impala, like the one we saw. However, you'll find there will almost certainly be a peak in this, around this time of year. And that's for most animals. There's more baboons. Where did you come from? Look at you all. Right, I'm going to stop saying our baboon sighting is over, because so far that has proved to be 100% false. And they keep popping out of everywhere. And there's one perfectly silhouetted. Now I hear tell, although I did not see it, and I'm quite sorry that I didn't see it, because I think it would have given me a good chuckle, that when you were with James yesterday on the sunset safari, Chandra, were you with James yesterday? You were, when the branch broke under the baboon. It sounded hilarious. I can only imagine that James's narration made it even more so. Apparently yesterday a baboon sat on a slightly rotten branch and it sort of caved underneath the baboon's weight. And you know, these dead trees are not always that stable. That's a very cool silhouette. Almost silhouette. Very good question from Anne about whether or not primates have different blood groups in the same way people do. I have absolutely no idea. I honestly don't. I am open to hearing about whether or not they have different blood types. I really don't know. My suspicion would be that for something like a chimpanzee, yes, since of course there's a very, very close... There's a very close relationship between the DNA of chimpanzees and the DNA of humans. Very, very little difference. Sorry, I'm just listening to James. He's just got up and out, driving our special guests around. I bet James would know. I have no idea, but that's a really good question. Down you go. And... dare I say our baboon sighting is over, or shall I be proved to be incorrect once again? It's entirely possible. They're still on Juma, so we might actually see them crossing Cheetah Cutline as we move a little bit further to the east. I honestly am... I'm thinking so much about the blood type now. It's really interesting. And a good morning to Gail. Speaking of baboons, which we don't. We have seen them a little bit more regularly. Dale. Not Gail. Dale. I'm sorry. Dale. Good morning to you, Dale. And Gail, if you want to know this as well, wherever you happen to be. But Dale, more specifically. Dale, you want to know if baboons will hunt and kill their own meat, or if they will rob from things like leopards. Now, they can. They can hunt their own. It is relatively unusual in times of plenty and in times of summer, but they are opportunistic, and you'll find that just like all of the predators, there are some that are more specialized in it than others. And it's most common examples of baboon predation. It's not even common enough for them to be called predators, but you'll find in most cases of baboon predation, it is impala lambs, just because they are so vulnerable, and it naturally will be the big males. And you'll find, from what I've read in the research, it seems to be that some baboon troops and some groups of males will be better specialized at it, and they'll actually learn, which primates do. All animals do to an extent, but primates, of course, are one of the groups that do it the best. They'll actually learn from each other how to go about hunting things like little impala lambs. It's unusual. I've never seen it. I have only ever seen videos or read about it. So I think it's something that we're unlikely to see on these live safaris, but goodness gracious, we have seen many unlikely things on these live safaris. And there you go, another question relating to baboon predation. And I feel like since we're talking about baboons, I might as well just try and poke my nose onto Cheetah Cutline, which is the eastern boundary of Juma. Barbara, you wanted to know if baboons will prey upon vervet monkeys. No. That's the interesting thing. They don't seem to. They're not on their menu. You'll probably find, just because animals and exceptions to all general rules, you'll probably find if you go back into records, you'll find there's one or two cases of a baboon killing a monkey that perhaps got too close to a baby or just upset them in some way, came into their personal space and was not tolerated by the very protective males. So you might find that there are cases of baboons killing monkeys, but they won't prey on them, no. And you'll often see them feeding in very close proximity to each other without any major conflict. I think it's because the monkeys are faster and more agile and, as I said, better climbers than baboons. As long as the monkeys stay out of the way, they're fine. Try for one last view. I'm very curious. Please can you let me know about blood types? Those of you that are in the know or perhaps happen to have Google at your fingertips, which is very useful because I don't, I would love to know about baboon blood types. Specifically, but also I wonder if that... No, don't go. Oh dear. X-Ranger wants to know what the purpose of having different blood groups is. Now you're taking me back to, I don't remember how old I was when I was learning about blood groups. I haven't done any learning about it since, X-Ranger. Let's have a look at a waterbuck. Or not. Or she could disappear behind a tree. I need to just stop and think for a second, X-Ranger, about the purpose behind different blood groups. I think it's just in terms of resilience, and it's to do with antibody... It's not to do with antibody receptors, it's protein receptors. Pardon? Oh, sorry. Chandra telling me that me covering my hat while I'm trying to think apparently has the profound effect of muffling my microphone, which makes sense seeing as my microphone is in my head. Sorry, Chandra and everybody else. I assume genetic variability in terms of different blood types, as with any genetic variability, is going to give certain sectors of a population certain resistance against certain things. I can't think exactly what the purpose apart from that of different blood types will be. I'm sorry, by the way, the baboons have not popped out. And we shall continue to wend our merry way towards a Cheetah Plains whilst I ponder the mysteries of blood types. If primates do If primates do have different blood types, do they have the same A's, B's, AB's, O's, negatives, positives? And do they have the same as us? Or do they not? That's another interesting question. Can't believe I've never thought of that before. Maybe I did. Maybe I learnt it once upon a time and it's gone. It's been erased from my memory. But very good questions coming through first thing this morning. So while I do some pondering on my long journey towards the Great Plains of the Cheetah, let's go over to Brent to see how his morning is going.
Well, we've now circled twice, and there was a report that the lions were at the Juma Pan, but I've just got a report that their tracks head deeper into Buffalo's Hook, so I'm a little bit confused. I can't find any tracks in this area, so I think we're going to go look for Queen Karula. Maybe the lions will pop up a little later. So the reason we went to look for the lions first is that nice cool morning like this, we were hoping they're going to be quite active and playing and jumping about. But alas, we cannot find them, so let's go look for a leopard. What you got? Oh, there we go, well spotted, Vim. Oh, he might not go far. One of the noisiest birds at the moment. You got him there, Vim. He's through the bush. I think there might be a gap there. There he is. A little to the right. A little bit to the right. There. There he is. A Le Valence cuckoo. Very, very noisy at the moment. All starlings beware, the brood parasite is here. So you often find Jacobin, Le Valence cuckoos in areas where there are lots of starlings. It's one of their favored brood parasites. One of their favorite hosts species. So for those of you not sure what a brood parasite is, all cuckoos are brood parasites. And what they do is they'll kick the eggs of a starling out, or that particular cuckoo, and lay their eggs in its place, and the starlings end up raising the cuckoo's chicks, doing all the hard work for them. Well, there's another one. Is he going to land out in the open? Also everywhere today. There we go. That one's landed out in the open. And I see a very distinct crest. Now there's two of these cuckoos you can get confused with, the Le Valence and the Jacobin. Now there we go, you can see that's definitely a Le Valence. You can just see the throat's quite dark and heavily streaked, whereas the Jacobin will have a much more white throat. All over the place, calling, making noise. There's another one there. Oh, he's off. And yes, this little section through here in the thickets around the Galago Pan seems to be striped cuckoo hangout, and there's always a lot of Burchell starlings here, so it could be that there's quite a few Burchell starlings nests in this area, and that is why all the cuckoos are here. Okay, so I know James is on his way to go check if Karula's still there. I think we're gonna go give him a hand. James is, of course, doing what I did yesterday and driving our guests. Sorry, just thought I saw a track there. James is going to check in from the east, we'll come down from the west. Just let him know. James, no sign of the pride around that area. I'm going to give you a hand following up on Karula. What are those impalas looking at? It's very pretty, light, the impalas steering to the north. Probably looking at James. Beautiful morning here in the Sabi Sands. There's a still pregnant female. A lovely, lovely light this morning. Now, I wonder if Hosana has rejoined Krula and Shongile. Not sure how they got split up, but there were baboon tracks in the area. That's a possibility. Now, wouldn't it be lovely if Karula just sets up shot on the edge of quarantine, all those baby impala? But I think they'll get a bit wise if she spends too long there. Just making sure she didn't sneak out towards Zoe's Road. So far, no tracks. Oh dear. Now, that was from the incredible wind I'm sure we've had in the last few days, that the dying and rotting boobean, it's lost some of its branches. Strong winds, dead trees. Don't like them. So this is the area where Karula was in yesterday, right down in the little dry riverbed there. Actually, you can see the tree she was under exactly from here. Here we go. That's the tree she was under yesterday. Nice big jackalberry tree. See a leopard in it, Vim? It's worth a check. And Shongile was climbing all over that tree yesterday. Michael's wondering how far was Hosana from where we saw Shongile and Krula. And not that far, Michael, a couple of hundred meters. Oh, watch out for VM's finger, he's just playing with some settings there. It's going to be a very bright day today. The sun is already shining brightly, and it's barely after 5 a.m. Okay, now, where's the route in from the west? Should be around here. There we go. That tree we looked at from the distance is just in front of us here. Now, the leopards might be lying a little way off that tree as well, so they could be anywhere around us. Vim sees there's some impala off to the right of us. Oh, there's a big stump. Now, impalas. That might not be the... Oh, I do hear an alarm call though, so it could be there. But I heard it. A Franklin. Sorry, James, go again. I copy. I'm gonna head down towards Philemon's. I'm just gonna try to check where the carcass was yesterday. Okay, so James says he hasn't had any luck. And it doesn't look like there's any impala left. Let's have a quick look from this side. And it doesn't look like anything's here. So the queen has moved on, but that's good. We like a little bit of a challenge, so we're gonna go try see if we can find her. So with a baby impala, there's not, oh, lots of spider webs. There's not much meat on it. So even between two of them, sorry, there we go, spider webs. It's not gonna last long. She might have gone to look for young Hosanna. So I think we're gonna head down towards that Philemon's dip area where we last saw him. Maybe we'll find some tracks of all three of them. Likes to make us work hard, Karula. That is not a good noise for a car that has just been serviced. Vim says his car makes that noise all the time. Vim, that does not fill me with hope and faith. Well, it started this time. There we go. We'll continue on. Fortunately, we were stuck. James was close by. He could have given us a lift home. Will he have given us a lift home is a completely different story. So we weren't, one of the reasons we looked for the lions off the bat is we were relatively confident that Karula was not going to be here with such a small carcass. It wouldn't have taken her too long, even with just one of the cubs present, to finish that. I know Dale was asking about something chasing Hosanna that he was separated from Karula. I didn't quite hear what, because the game drive radio was going. I'll wait for Final Control to enlighten me. Thank you. there seem to be no lumens coming from final control to lighten the situation. I'm guessing, Dale, that it would have been to do with baboons. Would they take advantage of him being away from the mom to attack? I think they would have attacked with the moms there or not, Dale, and especially a cub like that. But fortunately, I think after his last run-in with the Chakma baboons of Juma, he learned his lesson. Frank, and welcome to Safari Live. Frank is a new viewer. Frank would like to know approximately how many leopards do we have in our area. Well, Frank, in the Greater Kruger, which is 8.5 million acres, is estimated between 2,000 and 2,500 leopards. But in our area alone, leopards we see regularly 10, but in nearly 2 years, I think I've seen 26 or 27 different leopards. So some pass through, never to be seen again. Some set up territory. So, but regularly, I'd say it's probably 10. It's Karula, Shadow, Tundi, Nkanyeni, Tingana, Anderson. Who am I missing, VM? Sorry?
I wasn't counting.
Oh, you weren't counting with me. Okay. I'm trying to think now. Salahesh occasionally. So, and then you've got the youngsters that will be around for a while, like the cubs at the moment are 10 months old, Hosana and Shongile, that should be around for a few months yet. Copy, James. So James is gonna go check around from Zoe's. We're gonna go check down to Philemon's Dip. What are you staring at, Impala? Please be a leopard and please start snorting. Or lion. What are you staring so intently at? But no snorts just yet. It's always worth having a check. Now you're looking at us. Okay. Wasting my time, Impala. Wasting my time. Another new viewer, welcome. Oakhorn is wondering how Quarantine got its name. Well, this is Quarantine, it's open area to the left of us here. And of course, also Quarantine is also the name of a leopard. Well, this area got its name due to the fact that when they were attempting to farm cattle in this area, this is where the cattle were quarantined before they were moved off to other areas. And Quarantine the leopard got his name because this is after he became independent of his mum. He used to spend a lot of time hunting the impala around the quarantine clearings. Okay, so now we're in track mode. We've slowed down. We're going to go quite slowly, make sure we don't miss any footprints. Hopefully she hasn't moved too far south. And hopefully she's found young Hosana. Now, it's not that uncommon that leopard cubs get separated from their mom, and it can take a day or two to find them. So I wouldn't worry too much. And I saw him yesterday when driving our guests, and he was happily hunting squirrels up and down the riverbed. So I'm sure he'll be able to, as long as he doesn't let his food go, which he did the last time, he should be able to fend for himself for a few days by eating squirrels and bugs and things like that. So So most likely route for Kruller would have actually been to come straight down this river system, either to continue towards the Mawati, or she might have cut the block and headed towards Twin Dams. So that's what we're looking for very carefully, to see where exactly her tracks go. The last place we saw Hassana was just here and just downstream of Philemon's Dip. Always check carefully here. The last place I saw him was napping just down here. Of course, he could have moved. Now, when we get to road junctions, always a good place to look for tracks. Oh, not seeing any there. Oh, what's that there? No. Okay. So, and I said the next likely place for Kruller to have moved is to cut this corner through towards Treehouse Dam. So we'll do a little loop towards Treehouse and then come back down onto Weaver's Nest, check the edge of that little river system we last saw Hassana in. Going to go nice and slowly now. So for those of you new, when you see me sit like this and stick my head over the side, I'm in the tracking mode. You hear that, Vim? Dike is disappearing. There's another diker there, which is never bodes well for the presence of leopards. Let's just go have a quick look. Because Hassana might not have moved too far if he hasn't found his mum. Where was that squirrel sitting? Sitting here, looking, and we're looking that way. You see that? See the squirrel? Yeah, he's sticking his head out. Standing by. Byron, now we're following up on Kruller. She's not in the last position. So if you guys are willing to check in that area, it'd be great. Okay, so there's a squirrel. He stopped alarm calling now. Now, it could have been a slender mongoose he spotted. It could have been a bird of prey. I'm going to have a quick look around this area while we do that. It seems like Jamie has arrived in the Far East. Cheetah Plains. Let's go have a look.
Jumping all the way to the Far East, we are in fact and have arrived safely on Cheetah Plains and are just bumbling around to see what we can see. Well, the only thing so far that we've picked up are big male lion tracks that went into Cheetah, which is a property that is outside of our traverse area. So whilst the animals don't have fences, we do have restrictions as to where we can go. All lodges do. Certain places can go places that we can't and vice versa. The male lions, sounds like one of the Birmingham boys for now, although there were two sets of tracks are on Chitwa. And then there were tracks. You were talking about quarantine with Brent earlier. There were, in fact, tracks of one large male leopard crossing into Torchwood from the driveway. And it's always a little bit sad when you see tracks like that, because they were just so beautifully crisp and fresh that I knew that they were probably only a couple of hours old at the most. We not just missed him, but there was a point at which, not too long ago, a big male leopard walked all the way from Cheetah Plains and into Torchwood. My guess would be it's Quarantine, the leopard with the curious name, who I have had a chance to see only, I think I've only seen him three times, actually. So it's been a relatively rare experience that I've had to spend time with him. Brent, I know, has spent a great deal more time with him, obviously. I started working here just as Quarantine and Kanuma basically dispersed away from Juba. So I just missed out on seeing them. And I think, because as far as I know, Shimbambalana, who is their older brother, as far as I know, who I've never seen either, he doesn't really move that far west. Could also be Tingana. It is right on the boundary, or what we understand to be the boundary of his territory. I'm not sure which leopard it was, but a big male leopard went into Torchwood. Now, today is National Cheetah Day. Earlier on, we were talking about blood types. Now, there's an animal that I'm going to guess and say does not have any different blood types, just because cheetah are known for their exceptionally poor genetic variability. So at some point in the last couple of thousand years, it is International Cheetah Day. I suppose that is a very valid distinction. It is International Cheetah Day. But at some point in the last few thousand years ago, the cheetah population bottlenecked. And as a result, the surviving members of that particular bottleneck have very little genetic variability. But thank you to those of you who sent through all of the information on primate blood types, and to Diane and many others, very much appreciated. So apparently the answer to that is that old world monkeys, so we're right about chimpanzees, old world monkeys, which includes baboons, do show signs of having different blood types. The apes, they do express the AB, ABO antigens in their blood, whereas with something like baboons, it's not quite so clear. And it is expressed in other tissues of the body, but not necessarily in the blood. So there we go, some very interesting information coming through. An antigen, that was the word I was looking for, not antibody. Did you see that little antelope there, Jean-André? On the right, on the right of the tree. That doesn't really help you, does it? Oh, good, it moved. Thank you, little steambookie. Little female. Last time I was on Cheetah Plains, I saw a very pregnant female steenbok, but it wasn't quite here. Does that steenbok's tail look ridiculously short, or is it just that I haven't looked at a steenbok's tail in a while? Here we go. That is, in fact, for our new viewers, a full-sized antelope. That is her adult size. Oh, bye-bye. Spooked. That is, in fact, a full-sized antelope. They're just very, very, very small. Right, I have a question. Sorry. Can I take that away from you, Jean-André? Here we go. That's spiderweb number one. Apparently it's catching the light. Looks good. Happy? I'm happy. I don't see any more. Oh. It's okay, Jigga, I understand. Here we go. The trials, I say very jokingly, the trials of driving in summer, when all of the spiders have decided to string their webs out across the roads to catch insects during the night. Not nearly as bad as it would be if we were driving around river areas. In that case, you'd probably have to drive constantly with a stick trying to catch and collect all of the spider webs and keep them off the lens. There you go, I was just reaching for a spider web. Back to the topic I was talking about before I was distracted. Question, Jamie, on Jigger. If the old world monkeys, and the old world and the new world distinction is basically a purely geographical one. The old world monkeys this side, new world monkeys in the Americas. Does that include, I suppose it probably wouldn't, because they're not technically monkeys. They're primates, but they're one of the most primitive primates, and I'm thinking, of course, of bush babies, or galagos, as they are officially known, and they're all part of the loris family, or related to the lorises. I wonder if they would have different blood types in the same way that the older world monkeys do. I'm going to guess not. But that's a dangerous assumption to make. I'm going to be doing some more research on blood types this afternoon. That is what I foresee, because now I'm intrigued by the different expression of different blood types. Cheetah, as I said, I would be surprised if there's a huge amount of variability. And that is our project for the days, to try and find you some cheetah on International Cheetah Day. A celebration of one of the most unique of the big cats, and of course also one of the rarest in number. It would be very nice, but very, very unlikely, if we saw a female cheetah. Now, speaking of our big cats and speaking of female cheetah, which we unfortunately very seldom see, I think Brent said he saw one once in his time on driving around the northern Sabi sand. Virginia, good morning to you. You want to know in terms of cub statistics, because of course Brent started off the morning looking for lion and leopard cubs. I'm looking for cheetah. Statistically, what is the most likely to survive? What has the highest rate of survival? You'll probably find that it is lions. In terms of cub mortality, a cheetah really, really do struggle. And again, it's so difficult because cub mortality rates, I'm not going to say they're conjecture, because that's not actually what I mean. And they are based on science, but they can be very area specific. If you are in an area where there are no lions, for example, and very little competition, there's a chance that your female cheetah are going to be more successful in raising cubs, and therefore their success rate would be statistically higher. But I would say on average, lion cubs probably have the best chance, provided a male doesn't come in and take over the territory, because that of course drops your average right down, and your cub's survival rate is very, very low. So it would probably be lions, but there's not much in it. Cheetah are probably the worst off, especially in areas like the ones that we're in, or the ones that we move around in, where there is a large population of lions, concentration of lions in this area. Sorry, I'm just checking the vast open area of the Cheetah Plains. No wildebeest. That's also secretly what I'm hoping for, to be honest. Wildebeest calves. But there are none here this morning. Same as yesterday. Fine. Let's go to the southern section of the Cheetah Plains open area. Perhaps we'll find our cheetah there. Or wildebeest. I'd be quite happy with a wildebeest calf, since it feels as though our wildebeest herd on quarantine has abandoned us. Just checking for cheetah tracks. Nope. It is amazing to see the vast difference in these areas over the last few weeks. Where we We couldn't we couldn't go around a corner without encountering an elephant herd or a buffalo herd. Now, things are exceptionally quiet and it seems as though a lot of our big animals have disappeared off elsewhere. Now, that does mean that it will make Byron's life slightly easier as he moves out on foot. He is out and about, so let's head all the way back to Juma so that he can say good morning.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Bushwalk. My name is Byron. On camera with me this morning is Brian, so and the Thumb. So B&B back together again on walk this morning, though. And then we've got Aubrey walking with us, which is great. And we've come to a small marula tree, and not a very big one compared to some of the other large ones we get around here. Although it is fairly big, but they do get much, much bigger. But what I have picked up and found is a beautiful little seed that I'd like to show you, or the pip of the marula. Have a look at that. But what I wanted to show you, which I find so interesting, are these little holes. You see that? Now, that would have probably been done by a squirrel. So these seeds, or the pods, this is the marula fruit seed, and the seed contains little nuts in it, and they are very, very tasty. I have tasted them before, and what happens is the squirrel comes, sits down, finds these little nuts, and will dig it out of anywhere, even elephant dung. They'll find whole fruit or the seeds, and they'll try and bore out the little the nut inside, and they'll feed on it, and that's what's left. It looks almost alien-like, I suppose, but very, very interesting little seed pod. And in some villages, still, if you walk around in these areas, you can get the ladies will go out and collect marula fruit, and they return back to the village, and sometimes they make like a home brew out of it too. Or the ladies will be sitting outside their little houses or huts, and they'll take these little seeds and they'll crush them and get all the nuts out of them. And then they'll have them for the family, and they'll have them ready for that day. And very rich in protein, obviously, as nuts are, but very tasty. It's nice to have them out here. So we are going to continue our bush walk and see what we can find. We might see if we come across any tracks of Karula. I know Brent is looking for her. Just before, I did see something interesting that I wanted to show you over here. Before we do that, here we go, here it is. It's a beautiful little vine which grows along the ground with some beautiful pink flowers. These aren't open yet, but this is from a plant. This is called a devil's thorn. And it does indeed get very, very sharp thorns. I can't see one at the moment. With two little thorny parts off of a main little almost looks like a seed. But what's fascinating by this little plant is if locals, or especially the local woman, they would use this, they would take water and they'd wet the leaf quite a bit. And I don't have water with me now, but just even rubbing it like this, you get a very, very soft mucus almost, which starts forming. And they use that as shampoo. So they'll take a lot of this, they'll rub it together with water, and it gets very soapy, and this liquid comes out, which is quite soft and almost silky, I suppose is the best way to describe it. They would use it to wash their hair, and then also they would use it as a lubricant, especially for women who are potentially going to give birth. They would use a lot of this devil's thorn. They'd use it to help with that. So very, very interesting how you can find something like this out here. And it is soft, and it is very, very like I say, almost silky soft, watery base that you get out of this plant. Very, very interesting to see it out here, and these beautiful flowers, but then of course that sharp thorn, which I don't see at the moment. Maybe later in summer we'll start seeing more of those thorns around. Something interesting. Now, I know Jamie was looking for wildebeest calves, And we can't see a calf just yet, but I've seen an adult out in the clearing. Let's have a look. There we go. Might see it walking through the clearing. I think there's an adult wildebeest. It's by itself. So that could potentially mean that it's, and it looks like an adult male. Usually the females are in small groups or small herds, and that looks like it is a male. And he's potentially a dominant male who's trying to set up a little territory for himself. So it's not unusual to find a male by himself. What he'll do is find an area where there's perhaps good food for him to feed on, maybe a good rubbing post. That is a requirement for the wildebeest. They do need a nice tree to rub up against. And also a sandy little area. And if we go a little bit forward, I can see a little sandy spot. And I'll show you what they do. And then what that male wildebeest will do is set up his territory and just wait. Now hopefully some females will walk and join him in that area. And then he will do his best to defend that area against other males and protect those females and hopefully mate with them. So what he'll do is he'll find a nice sandy patch, very much like this one over here. And these wildebeest do like to dust bathe a lot. Helps protect their skin a little bit from the flies and the ticks that might sit on them. So they'll find an area and they go and they roll around and you'll get these like little scrapings on the ground and you'll find an area and it'll look almost something like that. You'll find a nice area, and when they start using it a lot, it actually hollows out slightly. You can imagine this big wildebeest lying and rolling in the sand constantly, and you get this beautiful little, almost like a bowl shape, very shallow, not deep at all, but you'll see a wildebeest rubbing very, very easily, and they'll go and roll in the sand and then move around, and they also use that to kind of mark their territory a little bit, and they might urinate in that area and also drop dung to keep other males out, and he will protect it. As I said, if any other males came into the area, he will run and chase them and try and chase them out of his territory so that he may then hopefully get some females around. And often you'll find these wildebeest will hang around in areas where there are impala, and we are in these clearings very close to camp, and we do see a lot of impala out here. I can't see any at the moment. They've possibly moved into the thicket already to go and feed for the day, but the reason why the wildebeest will choose to stay with them parlor is because it's a few extra sets of eyes to look out for potential danger, so any predators that might be around. Because he's by himself, it would help having other eyes around, keeping watch. So that is what they usually do, and it's not uncommon to also see wildebeest and zebra in the same area, purely because they feed on the same vegetation. They prefer the grass, they do prefer the clearings. Anyway, on that note, I think let us continue and see if we don't find any tracks of a female leopard. And while I do that, let's head back to Brent and get an update from him on where he is and what he's got.
Yes, we have enlisted Byron's aid in our search for Queen Karula. So what we've done is we've moved further to the south and we've done a big loop, making sure she hasn't popped out yet. Sorry, James is trying to get hold of me. Standing by. Copy, thanks. Good luck. So it sounds like the Nkrumahs have crossed out, unfortunately. So we'll keep checking for Queen Karula. We haven't found any signs of her track just yet. Nope, false alarm. Now I'm gonna go have a quick look down Ingwe Alley, that area there around Philemon, see if she didn't head further to the sort of east where young Hassana was wandering about. Standing by. Copy, do you want me to check towards Sydney's, that side? Copy. Well, where do you think my dash will come out? Copy. Thanks very much, William. Okay, so the lions have gone to Sibambili, but for everything that leaves, something must return. So there are tracks of wild dogs. James and William are following. They're heading straight north towards the gate. So I think we're going to leave Byron in this area, as leopards don't quite move as fast as dogs. I think Karula's still somewhere here, because there's no tracks crossing on roads where we would see tracks quite nicely. And, well, everyone knows how I love an African wild dog. By far my favourite animal out here in the bush. Now, with all the baby impala around, it's not impossible that Krula's made another kill quite quickly. Morning, Ali. Ali would like to know, are lions and wild dogs competitors? Well, all predators are theoretically competitors, and that's why they try to kill each other when they see each other. So the biggest threat outside of disease and lack of habitat and human beings to wild dogs is the lion. Lions probably kill more wild dogs than any other animal in terms of natural deaths. So they are in competition. Although they're not really competing for the same food species, you would say leopard and wild dog are far more in competition for the same food species. But the way the predators work, they will try to remove any other predator from around just to remove any potential competition for food. Okay. So we will come back, and we've got Byron and Aubrey wandering around here. So on foot, they've got a really good chance of seeing tracks that we might miss from a vehicle. So we're going to just do via tele-access straight up towards the gate, see if we find any sign of those wild dogs crossing, or hopefully even better, we find the wild dogs jogging towards quarantine. Now, if we do find wild dogs, I'm going to give you guys an early warning. Baby impala and wild dogs, well, it's great if you're a wild dog, it's really bad if you're a baby impala. My record in the space of about 20 minutes was 9 baby impala. In a day, it was about 22 baby impala. Okay, we're going to head to the hotel exit, and hopefully we're going to get to look at the dog in the meantime. Let's go to Byron.
Just after 6 a.m. here, and already I can feel it's going to be a very, very hot day. And something interesting that I just have spotted is what looks like the start of a termite mound. But why I find it so interesting is that this part of the termites have come and the bull.
Oh, sorry about that. It seems as though poor Byron lost signal on his bushwalk, but as you know, live safaris, sometimes things go wrong. There's a huge amount of technical know-how and things that go into bringing you live bushwalks, and sometimes they don't always work out exactly as planned. However, your timing is perfect, because I'm busy trying to puzzle something out, and it's something to do with the tracks that are on the ground in front of me. And we've got a male leopard track here. At first I thought I was looking at a cheetah track, and jumped out most excited. Not that I'm not excited to see a leopard track, but it seems as though it is not a cheetah. In fact, it definitely isn't a cheetah track. So I'm going to hop out to show you what it is you're looking at for those of you that are new to these safaris, just briefly. My puzzle is, I think this was the best one, wasn't it, John Doe? My puzzle is, these tracks are fresh, they're from last night. The question is, how fresh? So these are the toes, of the leopard. And there we go, that's the back of its foot, so the three lobes at the back of the foot. And just in terms of sheer size, it tells me immediately that it is in fact a male leopard and not a female. And the fresh, crisp, clear outlines of these tracks that might not be terribly clear to you, but to me, I can see that these were made last night, at the very least. And they're going straight north. What's that direction? West. I mean, straight northwest. Now, the question is, are they the same? Is this the same leopard that popped out and went to Torchwood? And has, in fact, been found on Torchwood, although it hasn't been clarified exactly who it was. Because let me give you a rough idea of where we are. Hold on. Let's see if I can make this work. Bear with me a second. Let me get up my map to help you to orientate yourself. So, I'm going to keep my screen in the shade just to reduce the glare. We are that blue dot over there. This is the Kruger National Park over here. This is Mala Mala down here. This is the road we've just driven on. Check the open areas. And when you last saw me, I was there at Cheetah Plains Pan. To the north of us is Nkoro. The tracks are going in a direct, this sort of direction. And the tracks that I found popped out roughly here on this road here and then crossed into Torchwood. Now, so that's the way in which, obviously that red line is the way in which we go into Cheetah Plains. Leopards can, when they're on a mission, they can and they do walk a very direct straight line. A lot of the time they don't, they. We all know that the joke about Karula and the fact that she doesn't necessarily pick a direction. But you see my dilemma here. I'm not 100% sure. They're roughly the same size. In fact, they're almost exactly the same size. We know that Shimbambalana and Quarantine move around these areas. So it could be two. It's quite a big, that's quite a big distance. But leopards move big distances all of the time. That distance is I just thought of something. No, it does make sense. I'm sorry, I'm just thinking, because they have found a leopard in Torchwood, but it's slightly just to the north of Nkoro. But that, it could be one of two, it's a little bit too confusing. So I think what we'll do is we'll check and see if we can't catch where the tracks are. Oh, awesome. Well done, Gendre. Cool. Wait, hold on. No, wait, come back. Wait, we want to just look at you. There you go. Okay, that's fine. You are beautiful. Hi. Isn't she beautiful? Or he? Beautiful. A mantis with a face that makes you clearly see what characters they are. Look at the antennas responding to my finger. Or not. Now it's stopped. It's absolutely wonderful. Well done, Gendre. Wonder if it'll box me, like the one that boxed James. Hello. Phenomenally lightning fast predators and predatory insects. Hello. With fantastically good eyesight. You can see those massive eyes that are now staring at me with what I can only describe as actually quite an intimidating expression. I'm not sure maybe if it's just the spacing of the eyes, but I do know that mantids can see very well. And then have a look at the hooks on the bottom of its legs. And that is what this particular insect uses to grab onto its prey. So a big thank you to Gendre for managing to catch this particular mantid. I have a horrifying knowledge of what lives inside the abdomen of... Is it swaying? I'm a leaf. So cool. I actually have a horrifying knowledge of what lives inside the abdomen of most of these mantids. And the reason I do is because I have a dog called Lexi. And Lexi grew up in the bush. She was brought into the bush when she was 7 weeks old. And she grew up in the bush. And one of the stages that she went through in her summer, in the summer months, was she kept chasing insects and she kept catching them, despite her best efforts. And, she nearly flew there. And what lives inside the abdomen of insects like mantids is something called a horsehair worm. It is a parasitic, almost tapeworm-like thing. But the amount, Lexi used to grab them, and I'm sorry, this is a slightly revolting description, so I apologize if I upset some of you with the more sensitive stomach. She used to grab them and she'd kill the mantid, and out of its abdomen would extend, I can't describe to you how many of these worms and how much space they must take up in this particular animal's abdomen. They're not all obviously infected with them, it is a type of parasite. And these horsehair worms are folded. They'll be... Oh, thank you. I think I just had a James-like effect on the mantid. Just defecated down the steering wheel onto my leg. I just had to check it out quickly. But yes, these horsehair worms are folded up, intricately folded up, inside the abdomen of the mantids, because, of course, they don't have blood vessels in the same way that human beings do. They have what's known as a hemocele, which is an open blood cavity. And apparently what happens with these horsehair worms is they eventually start to affect the nervous system of the insect and the brain of the insect, ultimately resulting in the insect drowning themselves because the worms reproduce in water. So once their life cycle is at that point where they want to reproduce, they drown their host. So utterly creepy things, really, really. And even the mantids that she caught and that I found these worms in are healthy specimens, just like this. They don't look any different. They look absolutely normal. Ooh, it actually gives me the shivers. It's like something out of a horror movie, I promise you. The insect world is a strange and fascinating place. Hey? Don't you want to turn for us slightly? Because your face is so beautiful. Although your back is as well. It's all right. On immobile, pretending not to be a living thing, hoping that I will, as all predators often do, I will lose interest. Can we go back down its back a little bit, Jandre? Just to the yellow spots on it. Looks like eyes to me, eye markings. Lots and lots of insects have those eye markings. Moths are thought to be a way of essentially intimidating, or basically saying to a predator, don't bother to attack me because I've seen you, even though the animal actually hasn't. Wow, Aqua, I had heard about that, and I have to confess, I find that horrifying, and I don't know why, maybe horrifying is the wrong word, although I hear what you're saying. So Aqua tells me that, and it's something I have heard before, that the mantis in the USA can catch hummingbirds. That's terrifying, isn't it? What is it about that, because we're okay with bee-eaters catching mantises, and hornbills catching mantises, but the thought of it working the other way around... I wonder what it is that makes us so innately afraid of that sort of thing, or makes us so, it feels so, it's not wrong, but it feels out of the swing of things, like the world has gone topsy-turvy. But thank you, Aqua, that is horrifying in its own way, the thought of a mantid that's able to catch a hummingbird. I mean, a hummingbird's not a big bird, but it's still... We often have conversations. Somehow I end up often having these conversations with Viam, strangely enough. Conversations about how lucky we are that evolution has not favored large insects. I mean, large as in the size of small dogs or something. Oh, we're getting a view of the wings. I wonder if it's injured in some way that it can't fly, or perhaps it's reaching the end of its life cycle. We often talk about, with our cheetah and our leopard and our lions, about the predator hierarchy. Ravi, you want to know, where do I think that mantids rank in terms of insect hierarchy. And very appropriately, as you said that, a spider-hunting wasp flew past. I didn't see it, but I could hear it. Ravi, I don't know that we can classify insects in quite the same way we can mammals, just because obviously there are so many different species of insects and their families are enormous. So we often when we're talking about the names of insects, we're actually talking about families rather than specific insects because they come in such a variety of shapes and sizes. A big mantid ranks probably quite high, along with something like a hunting wasp, like the spider hunting wasp that we saw. Longhorn beetles can be phenomenally intimidating, not longhorn, sorry, wood borer beetles, but that's not because they're predatory so much as they have these vicious looking mandibles. We're talking about insects, but in terms of arthropods, it gets even more complicated because then you start looking at spiders and scorpions and centipedes. So I think it's a little bit more tricky to classify properly in terms of a hierarchy. Is there a predatory insect that I'm forgetting? An actively predatory, yes, ground beetles. Ground beetles like assassin bugs and blister beetles, they're predatory. They run around catching things all the time. So it's a bit tricky to create a hierarchy, although mantids probably are relatively high. Now, our particular friend here is grabbing at my finger. I just wanted to see if I could turn her around. Seems to be sort of gearing up for a little bit of a... Every now and again, her wings come out. But I don't think this is a fully healthy mantid. I think it probably would have tried to fly away by now. Very good question from Heather. And I'm just trying to remember Heather. Heather wants to know if there's any local myths or stories regarding mantids. And there is one, and I'm just struggling to remember the detail. It also doesn't help that I've just recently watched Kung Fu Panda 3 in a moment of boneless exhaustion. And there was a mantid in that, that now I've got that in my head. I'll try and remember for you. I have definitely heard one. I have definitely read one. I'm sure there is some kind of story about their wisdom or something. They're meant to be very intelligent, very wise, or maybe... No, that doesn't come from Kung Fu Panda. Sorry, can I have my finger back? Thank you. Right, what are we going to do with you? You want to name him, Gendre? The mantid. Mallory. What did you go with? Manly the mantid. What if it's a lady? I did say him, you are right. Valid point. I quite like Mallory because it could be a surname, it could be a woman's name, or it could be a surname. See that leaf motion? Chameleons do it as well. I'm not sure any of you have seen that amazing footage of the chameleon hunting. I don't remember which documentary series it's in. Chameleon hunting, and there's a mantid hunting another insect, and then the chameleon gets it out of nowhere. His legs reaching up to try and find its way up my finger. What are we going to do with you, Mallory? Naughty, I'm going to get into trouble. Hello, yes, I'm talking about you. I love the head turn. What I want to do... Oh my word, look at that. Mandibles on this animal. And then the feelers around the front of the mandibles to help guide food into them. And of course, mantids have that profound reputation for eating their mates as soon as they've finished with them. They are very much predatory creatures. Rocking on my finger, pretending to be a leaf. And actually, it's relaxed completely now. Look, it's cleaning. Cleaning the joints of its legs. The feeder's hard at work. And now doing yoga. It's doing mantis yoga. Now cleaning the middle leg. That is so fascinating. Cleaning all of the mites and the dirt, and it's important that they stay clean. Otherwise, their segmented legs start to get stuck. Right, are we done now? Are we clean? Jandro, if I hold Mallory up close to your camera, will you be able to get a good view of the face or the jaws? I will bring it right up for you. How's that? Say hello to everyone, Mallory. You're one of the most famous mantises in the world now. Mantids. I need longer arms. I need Brent length arms for this. How's that? In this position, I definitely can't see what you're seeing. Hello. And that? It's shy. Jandre is assisting me by providing a tripod. There you go. An unprecedentedly cool view of a praying mantid. Right. I'm going to reposition my arm so that blood can flow once again to my fingertips. What are we going to do with you, Mallory? This has been such fun. Would you like to sit on my shoulder? You can feel the wind blowing through your antenna, because I don't think you're very healthy. I think you would have flown away if you could have. What do you say? Yes. Okay, well, how about you go there? It's nice and green. No, you can't come onto my face. You've got to go onto my shoulder. If you're going to stay here, you've got to be... Oh! Okay, fair enough. You are going to get so tangled. Okay, on the top of my head it is then. Mallory, off we go. Mallory the mantid has found itself in prime position. Let's go. Let's go see about these leopard tracks. Well done, Jandre. The fascinating find of the morning. Okay, I'm just going to drive slowly. I actually don't think, watch the thorns there. I actually don't think, unfortunately, as much as I would like to, I don't think Mallory can stay on the top of my hat. Hello? How's the breeze up there, Mallory? I will at some point have to remove my now pet praying mantid. I think that Mallory has been with us since we left the DRC. We did see it earlier as we got into the vehicle and then lost track of it. Well done to Jandre for finding it. Did you want to get off there, Mallory? To the left? To the right? I'll have to return Mallory back to whence it came from. He, she. Mallory will now be conducting your game drive. I'm done for the morning. Mallory's going to be narrating. I'm just the driver now. Okay, I'm really concerned it's going to go flying off. Ah, very nice reminder. No, Mallory. Mallory, I'm very fond of you, but you can't keep running up my sleeve. This isn't working out for me. It's not you, it's me. Oh. Goodness. Okay, alright. Okay, fine. Okay, here we go. So apparently, many of you sending through a little reminder that the alien in the Alien movies was based off praying mantids, and they are somewhat sinister. Are you stuck there now? I know you want, you obviously did want to be on the top of my head. Now what? Okay. Alright, you've just got to hold on. If you're going to stay there, you've just got to hold on. But yes, there's something quite sinister about mantids, so you can understand how they served the inspiration. Ah, there we go. I knew there was something. Hello, Brent in Final Control. How's Rusty? Apparently, Brent tells us that Rusty is not well. Not well at all. Brent tells us that from Final Control, that in mythology, in Bushman mythology, the mantid is the trickster god. And you can understand why. There it is. You can completely understand why, with their peculiar facial expressions and their very strange shape, why they might be a trickster god to the Bushmen and why they might have served as inspiration for the aliens in Alien. And now all I can think of is that combination plus the horsehair worms that live inside of them. It's very reminiscent of a certain scene in Alien. Right, with the vague feeling that I've completely lost my mind, I'm going to continue on the search for these leopard tracks. And while I do that, it will send you all the way back to Juma, to Byron, who seems to be working, and the bushwalk.
I hope you haven't lost your mind, Jamie. That wouldn't be very good, would it? Now, I'm just trying to have a look. We found a white berry bush. And I'm trying to see if there are some ripe ones. I haven't seen any or very many ripe ones just yet. They're still a little bit yellow. They do need to go a lot whiter. And they are very tasty though when they are ripe, but these are not just ripe yet. So I'm not going to taste any of these because they do taste a bit bitter when they are ripe. However, I think I've seen another tree just behind me that does look like it might be tasty, and it is indeed. This is definitely one of my favorite trees. It's called a buffalo thorn, and I'm sure some of you would have seen it before on the show. It is incredibly dangerous. I say that because look at those thorns. It's got one thorn pointing straight out and then one little hooked thorn pointing back, curved back. Now this is a fascinating tree, and I know a lot of guides do know this tree because it is a tree that we get out here a lot and they do speak about it a lot, but it is fascinating and it's got a lot of cultural connection to it too. Now firstly, let's get to how it was named, the buffalo thorn. So the scientific name is Ziziphus mucronata. But how it got its name, buffalo thorn, is apparently when lions would hunt buffalo, the buffalo would go and back themselves up into this tree, and they would stand with their horns facing out so they could protect themselves from the lions potentially coming from the front, and they'd have this tree behind them, and no lion would go through this. With these sharp thorns, it's very painful, and it would protect them. It's very, very thick, so it's impossible to get through it. So that's how it got its name, buffalo thorn. But what I find fascinating about it too is, if you have a look at this branch, it's almost, it zigzags. Do you see that? It changes direction. It goes like this, goes like. So with a lot of the African cultures, and especially Shangaan culture in this area, as I said, the thorns are very sharp. I've got to be watch out, I can't get too close to it. So a lot of the Shangaan cultures, or the African cultures, and especially the Shangaan culture, they believe that this tree represents, a branch could represent your life. So with this straight thorn, They believe that that represents your future going forward. The hooked thorn represents your past. And this zigzag on the branches represents how your life changes direction as you grow older. You perhaps change careers, if you get married or not, whatever, anything to do with your life. They believe that this is how your life changes direction, and I find that fascinating. I love stories like that. The other thing that is really a wonderful story about the buffalo thorn is that if somebody in the family passed away for some reason, old age, sickness, someone from that family would go and break a buffalo thorn branch. And I'm not going to do it now because they are... Oh, let's see if I can get a small one maybe. No, I think I'm just going to end up cutting myself. So they would break a branch of the buffalo thorn, and they would then take that to the area where that family member passed away. And they would be responsible for that branch. They would then go and wave the branch in that area where that family member died or passed away. And it is said that the thorns and the branches would capture their spirit. And they would then return home. And in some areas, they would be so careful at looking after this branch with this family spirit's member that even if they jumped onto a bus, they would have to buy two tickets, one for themselves and one for the departed that they were traveling with. And they would travel back home, they would take that branch, and they would bury it back with the family, back at the home, so that the spirit may be at rest and with the family. Isn't that a wonderful story? I do like stories like that. They're really, really incredible. The other nice thing about the buffalo thorn is there's so many uses for them. But these beautiful, crisp, green leaves are very, very tasty. And it's a general rule out here that if you find a tree that's got incredibly sharp thorns on them, the leaves are probably good to eat, because these thorns are there to protect them from browsers so that they don't eat the tree constantly. Other trees that don't have thorns and have big, what look like juicy leaves, probably have a very high tannin content, so they don't taste very good. So this would be really nice to eat, and I do know that these are very nice to eat. You can use it as a lettuce substitute in a salad, perhaps, if you aren't here. Quite crunchy, crisp, not bad tasting at all. Always remember, if you are eating something in the bush, make sure you're with an expert that knows what to eat. And you don't just pick and feed on things, or eat things rather, not feed. We're not not like a kudu. There's another little interesting thing with the buffalo thorn. This beautiful little fruit or seed, and when this ripens, what locals would do is they'd take the seed or the fruit and they'd grind it down, and they were able to make a bush coffee out of it, out of the buffalo thorn, buffalo thorn fruit. I've never tried it, unfortunately, and I do enjoy a cup of coffee now and then. So perhaps when they ripen, maybe we should come out, pick a few, and see if we can grind it down and make a bush coffee of sorts. I'm not going to eat this, though. This isn't ripe. It's still very, very green, so I'm going to leave this right here. What an incredible tree, though. Fascinating, and I love seeing the buffalo thorn trees out here. Even though I don't like driving past them, because if you drive past them and the branches are close to the vehicle, chances are you're probably going to get cut, and that tree will draw blood. There's no doubt about it. Those incredibly sharp thorns. But having said that, I have heard of stories where guides have been out tracking, walking in the bush, and perhaps bumped into a pride of lions, and the lions charged them and chased them, or a buffalo for that matter, and these guides have jumped into a buffalo thorn tree. jumped into the buffalo thorn tree to get away from the buffalo. And usually what happens is you have to go and cut them out because they can't climb out. Those thorns are just too bad. So they get up there very quickly, but then coming down is another story. So just be very, very careful if you do see that while you're around. All right, so we're going to continue on our walk, see what else we can find. And while I do that, it sounds like Brent is ready and back on Rusty. Let's go get an update. Well, we are out again, fortunately, after our brief interlude in Final Control, where we got to see a mantid crawling all over Jamie. I just got an update on Kruda's tracks. They're headed through to the north behind the dam wall. So I'm going to pop around towards the Mwati River around Spaghetti Junction, see if we've got any tracks there. And as I said, unfortunately, the Nkumas look like they have crossed. They look like they've crossed, though. Their tracks have crossed, and there are no tracks coming back. So hopefully they'll be back for the sunset safari. But till then, we're going to keep searching for the Queen of Juma, the magnificent Karuda. And hopefully she's been reunited with both Hosana and Shongile. And just to keep everyone updated, since we did mention him earlier this morning, a firm favorite leopard of everyone's, I think. It's safe to say everyone who's been watching for a while. Mr. Quarantine, Mr. Q, he has been found in a Torchwood on Inimpala Hill, so he is doing well. Unfortunately, he's not on GD plan, so Jamie is not going to be able to find him. Okay, no signs of any tracks yet. Also, I wouldn't mind some Ellies this morning, but Ellies have been really scarce at the moment. Just passing through, not hanging around too much. Okay, we have a nice soft sand coming up here to look for footprints. Nope. I'm hoping she's ducked down into the Mwati, maybe walking down the Mwati. It's another good area to hunt for Impala. You've got nice thickets on the edge of the Mwati River, and then you've got this open floodplain section that follows Twin Dams Road. Alex is 14 years old, and Alex would like to know, what do we see the Queen of Juma eating the most? Well, it really depends, Alex. At this time of the year, I think we're going to probably see her eating, the majority will be Impala, and more specifically, baby Impala. Sorry, I thought I heard something. Nah, it's just a bird. I thought I heard it was dwarf mongoose alarm call. Later on summer, we tend to see her, and early winter, we tend to see her eating more Steenbok and Grey Duiker. But you must remember that they are opportunists. So Nyala, Impala, Duiker, Steenbok, Young Kudu, all of those are all fair game for a Queen Karula. And we've seen her eat all of those. But in the last while, it's been Impala and Nyala, I would say, are the two main ones. We have seen her in a few Duiker kills as well. Well, actually, VM and I saw a killer duiker just over here. Must be a month or so back, maybe a bit longer than that. Okay, let's have a look here. Are there any tracks crossing the lovely soft sand of the Mwati riverbed? Going down deeper into the Mwati. Nope. Okay, let's go check Nyala Road South. Now, it does seem as the whippersnappers get a bit older,
She is moving a little bit further to the north in Juma again, and to the east. Oh, I wondered what that was that came flying in from the side. Hello, Mr. Dung Beetle. There you go. Now, dung beetles are fascinating creatures. Oh, there you go. My favorite thing about them is they haven't mastered the art of landing. They have not evolved to land well. So, and hence the heavy armoring. Oh, shame, he's going to fall off now. Okay, let's put him down. Don't fly into me. It's very rude. Go look for your dung somewhere else. Now, the funniest thing about them is when they do find a nice pile of dung, what they do is they just fly, and then they smell, oh, poo, and then they just close their wings. And so obviously they got very hard outer carapace, because they don't land elegantly like a butterfly or a wasp, or they just close their wings and collapse down there, and then they put their head up, and often they'll fall on their back, and then they got to jump themselves over, and then they smell it, and then they beeline straight for the feces. Squirrel, quite upset. Let's go forward a little bit. Oh, very upset. There is the culprit. Now, Mister, find us a leopard. Where's the leopard? What are you shouting at? Are you shouting for nothing? That's what you're shouting at. Shouting for possibly some loving. There's another squirrel climbing up towards it now that came off the ground. There's a leopard around. It's unlikely that they're going to be shouting from that low or coming off the ground. False alarm. I misinterpreted the squirrel language this morning. I need to brush up on my squirrel again. I was thinking they were saying leopard. They were actually saying, how do I put this delicately? It's time for loving. Yes, time to make babies in the squirrel world. Like most rodents, squirrels are prolific breeders. Okay, so we're just checking very carefully here. And when I started in February, when was that? What year are we in now, Vim? 2016, or February last year, Krula did spend a lot of time around here. Oh, hello. It's been driven over, it's a bit old. Let me just double check. Hi, Cola. Cola says, at least I can still speak lion. Yes, thank goodness. I must brush up on my squirrel, but my lion is adequate. Now, speaking of lions, Mfumo has headed way down to the east. I saw him quite late last night, right near the Kruger boundary with Tinyo. and the two of them were moving together. They might be heading down for a Cheetah Plains visit, who knows? While we keep checking Juma, let's go back to Jamie, who's got a tiny feathered friend.
Here's a bird that we haven't seen very many of, and this is a particularly scruffy looking one. I think maybe after its long migration, it's feeling a little bit the worse for the wear. We've stumbled upon a flock of European bee eaters. Glancing about, and I'm actually a little nervous to tell you the truth. I'm a bit scared one of them is going to come down and grab Mallory off the top of my head. So I'm keeping plenty of distance. Now, there was a whole flock of them. I'm going to try and see if I can't catch up with them. By the way, Mallory doesn't want to move. I have tried. a bit concerned, though, that with the presence of so many bee eaters, could suddenly be swiped from the top of my head. Where have these birds gone now? Hold on, sorry. Let me just try and... Oh, I think they're all going to fly off. And just quickly, while we're talking about Mallory, Dory, it is the mantids, actually, officially. The mantids. I'm trying to find you another European roller. I had a brief moment because that one was so Oh, I see you. I see you. Before that one was so... Because this one was so scruffy, I was actually a little bit... concerned about my IDing skills. Oh, sorry, I said roller. I said it's a European roller. I meant a European bee eater. I'm sorry. I'm having a moment of stupidity. Apologies. I did that earlier as well with Chandra. I kept calling it a European roller. So my sincere apologies. It is in fact a European bee eater, not a roller. The long and somewhat thin bill is the giveaway. It is a European bee eater. Sorry, everybody. I'm creating confusion. It's just caught something. I can see it swiping from side to side with its bill. That's why the bee eaters have these long, thin bills, is because, as their name suggests, they're quite good at catching stinging insects and keeping them a distance from their eyes and from their face, in order that they might protect their vital parts from stings. And then they scrape them. Well done, Jandre. There we go, now we can see it clearly. They scrape the insect across the along branches and so on. So a European bee eater. The flocks of them returned quite a few weeks ago, but we haven't seen all that many of them. We are, of course, still eagerly awaiting the return of the carmine bee eaters. In a second, I'll show you the different bee eaters that we get in my book and where the slight confusion was earlier. But most distinctively, look at the yellow throat. The yellow throat and the slightly dark brownish reddish brownish cap on the top of its head. This is for our new viewers who are IDing birds. And then the blue underneath. And they're quite mottled and they're a little bit scruffy. They have just flown a very, very long way, as you may have guessed from their names. And they have only recently, in the last few weeks, returned to our shores. Now, there we go. So there was a flock of European bee eaters. It is now two, and they are not rollers, they are bee eaters. There, three. Well done, Jandre. Jandre has got his spotting eyes in this morning. See, have a look also at the orlot. I was going to say at the slight point to the tail. Okay, so let's just do a quick IDing course for those of you that are new to our birds of this area. Let's start with our European roller. This is actually what you're looking at, believe it or not. And sometimes the diagrams in the bird books are slightly exaggerated in terms of coloration. And so this one, that is what I was trying to point out on the tail, that slight extension at the tip. But most importantly, the blue breast, the yellow throat, and the red-capped head. See what I mean about the long bill? That was a European bee eater. We also get a white-fronted bee eater, which is this one up here, with a yellow throat. Oh, yellow. That's not yellow. That's red. A red throat. And also with that ninja eye stripe, that black there, but with white, total white underneath it. And then, of course, it's quite rufous colored underneath and green on top. So those are the two bee eaters of similar size that you're most likely to get confused with each other. I have not seen any blue-cheeked bee eaters, which is this one, number four. I haven't seen any blue-cheeked bee eaters on drive. I don't know whether any of you have. They're relatively large bee eaters, and they are migrants. But I have not... Hold on, my book's about to blow closed. I haven't seen many of them. Now, the other one that we are eagerly awaiting is not on that page. The other one that we are eagerly awaiting is the carmine. Our carmine bee eaters with their brilliant pink coloration. Now, the carmine bee eaters is also one of the ones that we are still waiting for them to return. They tend to be quite late returners. We'll have to wait for them to come back to our shores. They often hang out around the Mulwati drainage. And just quickly, because we're doing different birds, you do get swallow-tailed bee eaters in certain areas around here. They're a lot smaller, and they have very forked tails, hence the name swallow-tailed bee eaters. I haven't seen any on our live drives. I'm not sure whether any of you have your swallow-tails on your bird lists. And then, of course, the springbuck bee eater, because it's the colors of our rugby team, our springbuck rugby team. Tiny, tiny little, it's actually called the little bee eater, not the springbuck bee eater. And there we go. Those are the bee eaters that you are likely to see, but really little, carmine, European and white-fronted are going to be the ones that you'll see the most. And just because we can, we'll do a literal reading of the bird that we just saw, a far-carrying frog-like call that goes prrup, croup, croup. And if that sounds completely bizarre to you, I'm just literally reading the way in which bird calls are written in bird books. And I'm only playing around because I don't know that I could do any better a job. And I know exactly what sound they make. They sort of do a chirp, chirp sound. Very distinctive, and you actually usually hear them before you see them. They can be very vocal birds. Stopping. Yes, have a jolly good groom. You could use it. You're not looking as brightly coloured and sparkling as you do usually. Who can blame them, though? That is a long migration. So there we have it for our budding birders. A bird perhaps to add to your bird list, and also, now that we've been over the identifying features, a bird that you'll be able to remember for the future. I'm going to get out of here before a bee eater snatches Mallory off my head. While I do that, let's go all the way back to Juma, to Byron, on walk.
So we are doing quite a few trees this morning, and it's nice to do some trees from time to time. I've found a very interesting one here. This is called a sour plum, and then you might be able to see a little green plum that is starting to ripen. It's not quite ripe yet. Here's another one lower down just over there. I can show you the size of them. That is it. However, this is still very, very unripe, still very, very green. So later, probably towards the end of December, we might start getting little plums, which are about, they get to about this size, bright, bright red, beautiful reddish color, and they are not called sour plums for nothing. These little fruits, they're tasty, but they're incredibly sour. And it is so funny to see people tasting them, and the faces, I mean, if you think of the most sour thing you can possibly think of, this is probably up there with it. So the face you pull when you bite into a sour plum is just incredible. It's really, really funny. But they are nice to eat. They are tasty. If you can get over that sour taste in the beginning, and it's usually the skin that is very, very sour. The fruit itself isn't too bad, but oh, it is incredibly sour. It's nice to see one. I will remember where this one is, so that maybe later in the month or possibly in January, drive past and hopefully there's still some fruit around for us to eat and to try. Now, we haven't found too much else just yet. It is incredibly hot at the moment. But we have been walking around just seeing if we can't find little insects. We've had quite a few birds, a lot of bird activity. We did, however, earlier see a buffalo track crossing the road and heading into this area in front of us. So we do need to be very, very careful, especially a buffalo, a lone buffalo. Those buffalo bulls can be quite unpredictable, so we just need to be cautious. Just make sure we, if he is still around, that we spot him, possibly before he sees us, or in time that we can just move away and avoid him. So we do have to be very, very alert while we are walking around. I found also quite a few little snake tracks crossing the road while we've been walking. I haven't been able to find it yet, or find any snakes yet. Well, not this morning. Just gonna try get over this tree. Here we go, Brian. Let me give you a hand. It's always fun climbing over these trees. Walking through the thickets, there's a rather large termite mound up ahead. It doesn't look active, but let's have a look. I always enjoy just scouting around a termite mound. Perhaps there's some other animal activity around there that we might be able to find. And speaking of trees, here is another tree. That is dead, unfortunately, but what I would like to show you is these wonderful knobs or protrusions off of this tree. And this is called a knob thorn. It's part of the acacia family. And one of the uses of these knobs is that apparently, I can't break one off, but if you had a toothache, people would break one of these knobs off and they would kind of crush it slightly and then put it in their mouth on that tooth that is sore. And apparently it alleviates the pain of a toothache. I've never tried it. I fortunately have got a dentist I go to, but I assume it works. A lot of people say it works, but I haven't tried it yet. And I really don't like dentists on the best of times. That's probably one of my fears, if I must be completely honest. I'm happy to walk around in the bush with buffalo and elephant and lions, but don't put me in a dentist chair. I just have to be cautious when you do come up onto these termite mounds, because you do have snakes in that may use abandoned termite mounds as homes. You could potentially have warthog around the area. We do know they burrow, they make holes and homes in abandoned termite mounds. So you do just have to keep a close look around and just make sure that you are careful when you do approach these termite mounds. There's some spider hunting wasps buzzing around me at the moment. There's beautiful large black wasps. But doesn't seem like anything else is around here at the moment. We're going to continue. And while I do that, I hear Jamie's got a friend on her vehicle, which is great, but there's apparently another bird that might want to eat it. Let's go have a look.
I have two friends in the form of courting kingfishers. And, they're gone again. It was two woodland kingfisher, and it looked as though the male had jumped down and caught something and was about to give it to the female before they both... there we go. I didn't even see that one, Jandre. Well done. The bright glare of the sun. Hold on, they're going backwards. I feel as though I'm exposing Mallory to significant risks this morning. It's not intentional. All of the birds that would eat Mallory, and we're seeing them all on the same road. Where's this kingfisher gone now that's there? Hold on one moment. Uh-oh. Oh, no, Mallory's there. Don't panic me like that, Rebecca. Here's our kingfisher. Oh, that was not ideal. It's sitting on the top there, Jandre, of the silver cluster leaf. Got it. Well done. Yes, you do have it. You do indeed have it. I'm sorry. It was a tricky one. Now there's our woodland kingfisher. I'm hesitant to linger for too long in case it boldly decides to snatch Mallory off the top of my head. Glancing around. Now, what I was hoping that I would have a chance to show you was the display of the woodland kingfisher, where they do that little wing-out dance. Many of you will be very familiar with it, but it's always thoroughly entertaining to watch as they go about their breeding process, looking a lot more sleek and well-groomed than perhaps the European bee-eaters that we saw earlier. Except that the journey of the, well, I suppose the journey of the woodland kingfisher is not nearly so long. They don't have to travel nearly so far. A very beautiful bird and a very vocal bird. And the reason I'm saying that they are a threat to Mallory is that kingfishers, it's a funny thing. It's not quite a misnomer because there are birds in the kingfisher family that fish, the pied and the giant being the prime examples in this area. But most of our kingfishers, from the woodland to the pygmy malachite, the brown and the grey-headed and the striped, they are all insect eaters primarily. And whilst they might skim the odd insect from the surface of water, for the most part they are not fishers. Now, the name kingfisher can be a little bit misleading, and in fact the majority of kingfishers are not in fact fishermen or fisher birds. They are of course related to the kookaburra. That if any of you have spotted the similarities and you're new to these safaris, that you are spot on. They are related to the kookaburras in Australia. Also, far carrying calls, much like the famous laugh of the kookaburra, except in the case of woodland and many other kingfishers, it's a beautiful whistling trill. Lovely. There were some parrots here earlier, but unfortunately they seem to have departed. Right, give it a few more seconds, see if male or female comes back. Very good question from Vulpine Wolfgirl. Now, Vulpine Wolfgirl, you wanted to know whether or not we get any of the birds that stash their food in on the thorns of trees, like the butcher bird, the shrikes of Europe. We do, and I just have to try and remember which species of shrikes, will actually stash their food on thorns, because there's only two species that do it. Pardon? Fiscal shrikes, yes, fiscal shrikes is one. Fiscal shrikes are the black and white ones. We don't see them all that often here, but there's one other. And the reason I remember this so, I should remember this so clearly, was it was a discussion during my trails guide assessment, where I was chatting, we were talking about different birds. And trails guide, by the way, is your walking, when you are qualifying to take people on walks. It is the redback shrike. That's what I was going to go with. The redback shrike and the fiscal shrikes are the ones that generally do it. And most of our other shrikes will not. Speaking of prey, Jandre? Where's Mallory? She gone. He, she. Aw, Mallory. How devastating. Perhaps took one look at the kingfisher. Oh, goodness. Rebecca shouting in my ear, steering wheel, steering wheel. You have a new friend for me as well. I can't keep track of all the friends you keep giving me, Jandre. I can't tell if you think maybe I'm lonely. Jandre's found us a longhorn. There we go, a longhorn beetle. I can't have two such different friends, Jandre. They won't get on very well. A longhorn beetle, of course, there are, of which there are many different types, is, it's not a difficult name to guess at why it was named that. It is called the longhorn beetle because it's got massive antennas that look like very, very long horns. Mallory, you're going to get squished there. Sorry, I'm just checking. Oops, sorry. Heading way. There we go. There's the longhorn beetle. Perhaps, Chandra, they're all coming to you. Maybe they wanted to be with you the whole time. You see the way the antennas are working there to guide this particular insect. I'm not giving this one a name. I can't keep track. And it's gone. It's on your hat. It is on your hat. All right, Chandra's got his longhorn. No, you can. We can both have a hat insect. It's fine. You don't have to give it to me. Okay. Well, we'll prove that it is, in fact, on Chandra's hat. There is the longhorn. I think we've both lost it, Chandra. I really do. I think we've gone completely loopy. It does give us a really nice opportunity to closely examine the insect life that perhaps we might not otherwise have. Apparently one of you questioning who on earth provides us, who goes and fills up the vehicle with insects, so that Brent and myself have something to talk about when the animal life is, or at least the mammal life, is scarce. Good question. I'm going to go with the electric light that sits above the vehicles. I'm going to say that plays a little bit of a role in... Oh, there you go, Chandra. There's your friend. My Mallory is still underneath the steering wheel. You're going to get crushed there, Mallory. What happens if I need to turn a corner? Well, I suppose you can stay at the bottom there. All right. Well, we'll transport Mallory safely home. As I said, I don't think Mallory's very well. And we shall put her or him back where he came from. Since he, she did originate from the Juma parking garage where we keep our vehicles. It is the electric light, because of course that attracts moths, which in turn attracts the predators of moths, such as Mallory, who's staring at me upside down. Chandra also raised a good example of predatory insects, by the way. We were talking about it earlier in the predator hierarchy, and I said, did I miss some? And of course I did. It was difficult to think of a complete list off the top of my head, but antlion larvae are a really prime example of a particularly predatory type of creature. Horrible, hideous looking things. I mean, shame, that's a bit mean. The adults are beautiful. They do turn into, they are the perfect African example of the ugly duckling turning into the beautiful swan, because the adult antlions are gorgeous. But the antlion larvae themselves are these horrible round sand-colored creatures with giant jaws that build conical tip pits in the soil. Many of you will be familiar with them, and snatch and grab any poor hapless creature that happens to stumble into their pits of doom. Yep, there's definitely a screw loose this morning. I don't know, Chandra, if you feel much the same. I do feel as though something's come off or is rattling around in my head somewhere. Another thing I can tell you is that Cheetah Plains, in terms of mammal life, is very, very quiet. And unfortunately, no sign of our cheetah for International Cheetah Day. I've searched high and low. I've basically driven all of the cheetah's areas on Cheetah Plains, and there's no sign of them. Now, Frank, you want to know if Mallory perhaps should get hazard pay for all of the danger we are exposing Mallory to due to the bird drive. Very valid point. I will negotiate with Mallory, Frank, and I will get back to you on that subject after I have discovered. I'm not sure, Frank, if you're offering perhaps to be Mallory's representative in this dispute. It's not really a dispute, it's a negotiation. But while I contemplate what we should pay Mallory in terms of danger pay, let's go back over to Juma, to Brent, who might be slightly more sane.
I doubt I'm more sane. I doubt it. What do you think, Vim? Who's more crazy, Jamie or me? There we go. As Vim says, you're all a bunch of nuts. I think he's referring to all presenters. Yes, we do spend a lot of time in the harsh African sun. It does tend to make us wander a little bit. Only joking. So Last Track's crew go into this really, really terrible block full of little ravines and that. So fingers crossed that she pops out. So we're going to do a loop around it and hopefully we get some luck. Now, since it is International Shikankanka Day, or International Cheetah Day, I think we're going to have a few little Shikankanka quizzes. And, let's think. What is an interesting fact about cheetah? I think you guys know this one too well, but we'll start off with it. Nice easy one to get going. And if you know this, because I know I've asked it before, give some of our new viewers a chance to answer first, and then I'll do a harder one for everyone just now. So, where and in what country is the largest meta population of cheetah? Now, when I say meta population, it means the largest population of individuals with the most genetic difference, and generally also means the largest number. So what area, what country has the largest meta population of the cheetah? If you know the answer, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. I look forward to hearing from you. Hello, Anna-Marie. Anna-Marie is wondering, do I think there's a chance the cheetah might become extinct because of their weak genetics? I do, Anna-Marie. I think they're probably going to be extinct within the next 1,000 years or so, or maybe 2,000 years. And it is, cheetah, unfortunately, are probably just going to be one of those failed arms of the evolutionary tree. And just think how lucky we are to see them. So as sad as it is, a natural extinction, and that is caused by their lack of genetic difference and their over-specialization for speed. Now, there's a lovely folklore about cheetah, and how did a cheetah get its tears? So when you look at a picture of a cheetah, they've got black tears running down its face. So a mother cheetah had, I think it was four cubs or three cubs. Three cubs, let's call it three cubs. And like most predators, they will hide their cubs while they go off hunting or go to do something. And there was a very lazy hunter. A human hunter, that is. And he was sitting under an acacia tree going, oh, whoa, oh dear, I'm too lazy to hunt today. I wish there was an easier way. And while he was lazing under his acacia tree, he noticed the mother cheetah sprint out, whack an impala, and then call her cubs. And her three cubs started feasting upon said impala. And the lazy hunter went, yo. If I had a cheetah, it could do all my hunting for me. And then I could just lie in the shade and drink beer all day. That is a good plan. So the mother cheetah left to go have a drink of water and head to her cubs. And the lazy hunter took one cub. And he thought, yeah, now. Now I'm sorted. This little cheetah, when it's a bit older, is gonna do all the hunting for me, and I'm gonna sit in the shade and drink beer. But then he thought, you know what? If I have two cubs, I can actually trade meat and get free beer. No, let me take two. And you know what? I could even get someone to build my house. If I have three cubs to do all the hunting, so I'll take three cubs. And off the lazy hunter went, disappeared with the female cheetah's three cubs. She came back after having a drink and all her cubs were gone. So she started crying, and she cried for 3 days till eventually one of the village elders went and said, "But Madam Cheetah, what is the fault?" She's like, "My cubs are gone, my cubs are gone. Someone has taken my cubs." And the village elder said, "What dastardly creature would do that?" And the village started helping the cheetah look for its cubs. And eventually they were found in the lazy hunter's hut. And this was after about a week of constant tears streaming down the female cheetah's face. And the village elder returned the cheetah cubs to the mother. But by the time the cubs had returned, she'd cried so much it stained her face. And the lazy hunter was then banished and beaten with a large stick. Anyway, that's a Zulu folklore about greed. So one must remember that most of these African folklores were what we would call school. Teach the kids not to do bad things and have bad habits. So that one's about greed and what greed can do to other people. Oh, there are some elephant tracks here. Oh, this could be nice. I haven't seen Ellie's in some time. Or 2 days. Just one, looks like one elephant ball here. But we are also checking very carefully for Madame Karula's tracks, see if she popped out of this terrible section of ravines. Oh, so thank you to the people who knew the answer for not answering straight away and giving everyone a chance. So the answer to the meta population of cheetah in Africa, you guys have fallen into my trap. So we've had Kenya and Tanzania, and it is not either, strangely enough. Now there's a healthy population of cheetah in Kenya and Tanzania, and the Mara and the Serengeti and also the Maswa and other areas, but it is not the largest meta population of cheetah in Africa. Come on, Karula, just be lounging in a tree. We can see your tail hanging down. Actually, one of the few places I've seen cheetah on Juma was right here. So you never know, maybe International Cheetah Day, they've decided to come to Juma instead of Cheetah Plains. So there we go again, and not Botswana. It's an interesting one, and I'll give you guys a little bit longer. Okay, Vim, I'm not sure, I could be, oh, you. Okay, we're going to that back marula there. It's a long shot, but it could be a little bit higher. Let me just have a look now. A little bit to the left, I think. A little bit higher. Do you see it? We're looking for a yellow dot in that thick, a little bit to the left, maybe. So it was a European oriole. European golden oriole, but it just did a disappearing act. Maybe if we go forward a bit. Oh, no. Okay. I thought I saw it pop out in that fork. Oh, it was too quick for me. I think it did a... Oh, there's something else to the bottom right, but I don't know if that's the oriole. Let me come out a little bit, Vim. A little bit lower, the bottom branch there, somewhere around... A little bit more to the right. It's behind that. I think it's gone behind that. Oh, they're jumping up to the... So, there on the screen, Vim. There. Okay, you got it. What was that? I didn't think that was the oriole there. It was... You can see... Oh, it disappeared out the back. Ah. But that wasn't the oriole. But we still haven't managed to get a European golden oriole on camera. They're quite tricky. Now, but again, Botswana has a very healthy population of cheetah up in the north and in the south.
Yes, we go. And then one last guess was Namibia, which is also incorrect, although they do have a very healthy population. But the largest meta population, well done Gail, in Australia is indeed South Africa and the Greater Kruger National Park. Now, looking at this, you would think, what would a cheetah want to be doing in this? But strangely enough, over a lot of their habitat, they do occur in mixed woodland like this, and they are quite successful in it. So, of course, they've become iconic on the open plains, but they will utilize areas like this just as readily. Okay, now I'm going to give you one more cheetah quiz, but not just yet. And while I think about which one to give you, Byron has got a hairy and a scary.
So have a look at this beautiful caterpillar we have found. And it's a worm of sorts. It is a caterpillar, but this is apparently a larger form of the bagworm, which I've not seen this size before, but we are with Aubrey, and Aubrey was explaining to me something very interesting about them. And usually you might have seen some of this before, one of these before, but what happens is these bagworms form these little casings. What they do is they pack, occasionally they pack thorns closely together, and this isn't one, but it looks like this. They'll pack thorns closely together, and what they do is the worm lives inside, and then it pulls this little pupa or casing with it, and then it will pupate inside here. So they do move along with that, and it's called the bagworm. Now, Aubrey was explaining to me that occasionally they believe that if their cattle eat these bagworms, they do die from it. They're incredibly poisonous. Now, which is interesting, and I've never seen one looking like this or this size before. So it is interesting to see, and there's always little firsts that we get out here. But you can see it is feeding on the leaf, just around there. It's been feeeding on the leaf, and it's quite well hidden, fairly well camouflaged. But I'm sure if a bird had to see that, I'd be interested to know if they do feed on them. I'm not sure. Like I said, I've not seen one that size before, so it's very, very interesting to see something different. And that's a wonderful thing about being on these walks and having a look at insects in different areas. You always find little new insects, new little things that we possibly haven't seen yet. Unless you have people and scientists that come out and study specific bugs and looking for specific insects, sometimes we don't always see them. And also, they tend to be seasonal. Sometimes in winter you don't see any. Summer also, not necessarily throughout the summer, maybe short periods of time in the summer that some of these bugs come out that we see. And I know Jamie was speaking about antlions earlier too, so I'm going to see if I can find a little antlion hole. Nothing just yet, but I'll keep my eyes open just so we can show you what a little antlion hole looks like. It is still very, very hot, as you can see, sweating a little bit here. But there's a bit of a cool breeze which has just picked up now. It's lovely, really, really nice. It makes it a lot more pleasant to walk. So I thought I saw something move here. And that's the other thing. Sometimes you get these tiny little creatures, little insects moving very quickly. When you have a look, they disappear. Some of them are very, very well camouflaged. So what we're going to do is we're going to start heading back in the direction of camp. Anna, interesting question. Now, you want to know about the vegetation. We've been speaking about trees all morning, and you wanted to know how mixed woodland differs from jungle. Now, mixed woodland is generally, so this area that we are in, for example, is mixed woodland. So what it is you've got a number of different tree species around here, but they're not on top of one another. There are still gaps and grassy areas in between them, but you have a mixture and a variety of trees growing in an area, but there is still space between the canopies. You don't have trees right on top of one another. Certain areas might be a lot thicker than others, and that is generally mixed woodland. With jungles, you need to remember that jungles are generally areas where the forest is basically the vegetation's on top of one another, and the canopy forms almost one canopy. Very, very thick vegetation, very, very thick, and also a lot more humid than probably what we have out here. That's generally jungle. Jungle and forest is very thick vegetation. It closes up completely and the canopies usually touch, whereas mixed woodland, it's a lot sparser with trees all over. And then you have the grassland, where it's generally grass as far as the eye can see, very flat open areas. The best example of that would be up in East Africa, Kenya, Tanzania, up in the Mara, where James was earlier this year. You get those beautiful open grasslands where the grass all forms one blanket or one layer that you can see for as far as the eye can see, and every now and then you'll see a few trees dotted around. But this area that we are in, mixed woodland, a lot more trees, close together, but not quite closing a canopy like you would get in a forest or in a jungle. So we're going to continue. As I said, we're going to probably head back towards camp now. Just because well, time's starting to run on. We've got a fair amount of distance away. We need to be and I wanted to check these water holes just in case something was potentially coming down to drink, but it doesn't look like there's any wildlife around at the moment. But just because we don't have doesn't mean there isn't any out here. Brent has got an impala he'd like to show you.
Those babies are all legs. A runway model would be proud to have legs like that. I mean, they're almost the same size as the adult's legs on a body, an eighth of the size. They are just very sweet looking little critters. Sticking close to mom. Oh, let's just go forward. There's one having a snooze. No, it didn't like me starting the car. It decided to wake up. Now, as it gets hot and they sit down to ruminate, you'll often find little nursery groups of baby impalas. So you'll find five or six, sometimes even more. Oh, hello. Hi, Ma. It's hot, Ma. Don't make me get up, Ma. See, already ruminating. So even though they are heavily reliant on their mother's milk, they have already started feeding on grass and leaves at this very, very young age. So they are a very precocial species. So miniature formed versions of the adults, able to run and feed within run within minutes of birth and able to feed on grass and leaves within, oh, I got a fright from the oxpecker. Within a day or so of being born. As impalas are not enjoying that oxpecker. So as it gets warmer today, and I think today is going to be a very hot day, you're going to find groups of impala like this coming into the shade under the big marulas in the open areas and ruminating away, chewing the cud. Oh, thirsty. See how they headbutt mom's udder to stimulate milk production? Unfortunately, I think the impalas are quite tough because that looked like quite a serious headbutt there. Oh, hello, friend. Even their eyes are too big for their heads at the moment. Oh, very tender. Sweet little things. Okay, well, we're gonna leave them. I still haven't forgotten about your last cheetah quiz, but it seems like Jamie has the tortoise that could.
I have the tortoise that did. A little leopard tortoise that managed to surmount the massive obstacle that was put in its way in terms of climbing over a sandbank. But I just wanted to draw your attention to the fact that this might be the most beautiful. Are you not? No, you silly bean. Oh dear. And we're back down the sandbank. What on earth was the point of that entire struggle, you silly creature? I was about to point out to you that you are probably looking at one of the most beautiful leopard tortoises in the world. Certainly one of the prettiest that I've ever seen. It just goes to show what kind of a role genetics will play in the colours and the patterns on a tortoise's shell. It's still a leopard tortoise, but it's very smooth and shiny. Little tortoise, you are very silly. Why did you cross the road, climb up the sandbank, unless it was for the slide? Maybe the slide is fun. And go all the way back again. What a silly thing to do. I mean, everything, walking across the road is no small feat when you're a tiny little tortoise, and this is a tiny little tortoise. Just a little bit larger than the little ones that Steph and myself have seen. Look at him go! Racing across, highly mobile. And this is the champion sprinter of all tortoises, this little one. Now what? Now you've got to the next sandbank. At least you found some shade there, you silly thing. Okay, this is a much easier incline than the one before, isn't it? No, don't do it. Don't do it. Oh! Are we going back? On its own little mission. I would love to know what's going through that little tortoise's head. Is it after shade? Is it after food? Or does it just really like crossing roads? There we go. That's a bit more of a sensible decision, little tortoise. The little tortoise that could and did twice. Safely cross one of the main roads, and off it goes. Our leopard tortoise is slowly mobile, or highly mobile, into Chitwa. Whoop. So cute. Where have you gone now? Lost it. Where'd it go? The little tortoise that vanished. I can't see it anymore. Oh well, it was a lovely sighting of really what was the prettiest leopard tortoise. It was all sort of, it was as though somebody had come along during the night and polished its shell really nicely. All right, well, since our little tortoise that could has vanished, I think we should go over to Brent, because I'm sure you're all anxious for answers about his cheetah quiz.
I haven't forgotten about our cheetah quiz. So, let's think about this one. Yes, this is the one. So, It's almost a two-part quiz. So the first is, what country outside of Africa still has a wild population of cheetah? And what country in the last 100 years outside of Africa has lost its cheetah? And it's the only animal to become extinct in the last 100 years in that country. And which are those two countries? So which country outside of Africa still has a wild population of cheetah? And which country in sort of the 1940s lost its wild population of cheetah? Think about it. Let me know. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Now, while we continue on, interesting fact about cheetahs. Can you believe that, what's it, I think it was 1700 BC, the ancient Egyptians actually tamed cheetah is the wrong word, domesticated cheetah, sort of. So they used to use them like greyhounds to hunt gazelles. But they would sometimes have them on leashes with blindfolds, and then they would get dogs to flush the gazelle and then let the cheetah off its leash. Now, that was passed on through the Persian Empire and into India, where that practice was continued till the 20th century. So people were still using cheetah like you would use a greyhound to hunt things in the 20th century. And a lot of the great sort of Asiatic rulers, and Genghis Khan, Charlemagne, all of them had cheetahs that actually used to live and roam free out in their palace grounds, or sort of roam free. They were obviously fenced in. So out of all the big cats, cheetahs by far the least aggressive and by the far the most timid and easiest to subdue. Now, of course, this is a problem for cheetah because, there's a couple of problems cheetah have. One is that they've got such an unsuccessful breeding. Such an unsuccessful breeding strategy, and they don't breed well in captivity. But because they are so docile and whatnot, they're often sought after by petting zoos and bad volunteer programs and things like that. So if you ever come out to Africa and someone says, come pet a cheetah, you're generally funding bad stuff. So you shouldn't pet any big cat. It doesn't matter where you are in the world, and generally those animals have not a great quality of life being kept in captivity. Now, there are registered breeding programs like DeWild, but again, it's so difficult for cheetah to breed in captivity. I mean, it's difficult for in the wild. You need a male biased sex ratio, and females have to turn down sometimes 3 or 4 males before they're prepared to mate. So it's a very interesting thing, and a lot of those factors are the reason that cheetah are probably going to become extinct in the next 2,000-3,000 years. Now, speaking of cats and other cats, well, Karula has evaded us completely. Last tracks went down near Vuyatela into that really thick area of lots of steep little drainage lines to the north of Gallagher camp, and unfortunately we haven't been able to find her. It doesn't look like she's come out, but there's no signs of the cubs with her. So I keep wondering whether Shongile is maybe hiding on the western edge of quarantine and with Hosanna, or for Hosanna's maybe still somewhere a little bit further to the north. So hi, Janet. Janet, you're 50% correct. No, you're not. Sorry, I apologize completely. No, Janet, you're not correct. So Russia hasn't had cheetah in the last while, and India does not have a wild population of cheetah. So no, close though, Janet, getting close. Well, we're getting closer. Iraq, historically, but they don't have any more. Morocco is in Africa, and they are locally extinct in Morocco, unfortunately. But that's in Africa. So it's a tricky one. And there's only 60 or 70 individuals in that wild population that is left outside of Africa. Oh, there's a gnu. The Inkahuma Brat Pack says Iran, indeed Iran is the country that's got about 60 or 70 wild cheetahs left. Now I'm just having a look at Mr. Wildebeest. No ladies with him today, but Inkahuma Brat Pack also said Asia, which I suppose is technically true, but I was looking for a more specific spot in Asia, and it is India. In fact, the cheetahs went extinct in India in the 1940s. Now, there was a big push to reintroduce cheetah into India from an African population. But this got put on hold for the moment. It was from doing genetic tests on Indian cheetah skins and African cheetah skins. It seems they diverged from each other about between 60 and 30,000 years ago. So that would have been before the great die out. So quite interesting. And there's, I know they're still doing stuff with the Iranian cheetah to see if they might possibly have similar genetic markers to the Indian cheetah that went extinct. But again, it's very difficult to reintroduce something that is critically endangered from a country. There's only 60 or 70 of them left in the wild in Iran, and I don't think they're very few in breeding projects as well. So a very, very interesting thing, cheetahs. One has to wonder with some of the Asiatic cheetah and whatnot. I mean, they occurred in India naturally for many thousands of years, but they seem to die off quicker than the African. And we're putting an African cheetah back there. Was the Asiatic cheetah going to go extinct naturally? There's all those questions, and it's one of those funny things. We like to try fix things, but sometimes it's not for us to fix. So they're doing a bit more research before they think about reintroducing a cheetah into India. Now, so yeah, Indian princes were the last to still use cheetah as hunting dogs, or basically hunting tools. And then the last sort of really big public figure or state figure, is they've always been associated with royalty and class, you know. So that Emperor Haile Selassie of Ethiopia, before the coup that sent him on his way by Mengistu, was often appeared in public and in royal photographs with a cheetah on a leash. Oh, here we go. Don't fly away, please. There we go. Oh, of course they fly away. The red-billed wood hoopoes. Oh, now in silhouette due to the light. The light is getting really harsh really early now as we move into the hot, hot summer months. You still got him there, yeah, I can't see him. Or maybe it's just, it's too looking too much at the light there. We're the opposite. We don't rage against the dying of the light. We rage against the light getting brighter and making our camera shots a bit more difficult. Yes, I did quote Dylan Thomas. Well done, VMP. Well, my little brother's named after Dylan Thomas. According to my mother, according to my father, he's named after Bob Dylan. Okay, well, where are all the kitty cats? Oh, we know where the Inkahumas are, and it sounds like they've just found one, Birmingham and Buffalo's Hook. Oh, well, no, it's not what I thought it was. It is just a noisy go-away bird. Now, also, if you might have noticed, for those of you who've been watching for a long time, I've been looping quarantine. Now, I was hoping with the rain we've had that we were going to get some wild flowers, and I've been searching extensively for a couple of my favorites, but it just doesn't seem like we've had enough rain on quarantine to get that real spurt of splendid flowers. I think this afternoon I might head down towards Cheetah Cutline. There's been a bit more bit more rain that side, so I'm hoping that there may be a few more flowers on Cheetah Cutline. But while we continue our search for birds, leopards, wildflowers, and anything in fact, let's go see how Jamie's doing now that she's back on Juma.
I'm thinking that for this afternoon at least, not that I don't like flowers, but I am rather hoping that perhaps we might have a chance to see cheetah. Well, the International Cheetah Day is not yet over, at least here in South Africa, but we still have that chance. And just bear with me one moment, I'm going to speed up because I just spotted something, and it's very pretty. To finish off our quiet morning, at least for Jandre and myself, we had one steenbok, one tortoise, one impala. So, oh, we had baboons in the beginning. We did have baboons in the beginning. And, of course, Mallory. Well, you horrible Bataleer. It was sitting perched so beautifully. Uh-oh. Heard me. Too close. It was too close. It flew right over us. Jandre did his best. Well done, Jandre. He was, in fact, a boy Bataleer. A male. Sorry. Shouldn't really call it a boy. It was a male Bataleer. That was a little bit incorrect. All right. So, in that case, we'll just have to try again on the sunset safari for the elusive cheetah. Now, speaking of a cheetah on International Cheetah Day, no, Liz, I have never seen... You know what it's going to do? It's going to come and land behind us. Well done, Jandre. Jandre determined to... No. No, oh, there he is. Sorry, Liz, hold on a moment. Wobbling away. The very characteristic flight style of a Bataleer. Or a short-tailed snake eagle. Listen, I've never seen a king cheetah in the wild. I've only ever seen them at breeding programs like the De Wild Cheetah Program, that where they deliberately select for, in certain areas, they deliberately select for that particular gene. So whilst I have seen king cheetah, it's never been in the wild. And king cheetah, of course, is just a cheetah with they're slightly larger, it seems, very clearly defined markings, much thicker. The black spots are basically black stripes, and they're quite beautiful. And I think so unique looking, hence the name King Cheetah. Oh, goodness. Can turn my game drive radio down. We have reached the final moments of the sunrise safari. I'm sure you're all wondering about Mallory, just before we do our finishing touches. You all want to know where Mallory... Mallory wants to keep Mallory as a pet, but I have to keep reminding her that mantises are for life, not just for Christmas. Although in the case of mantises, that might actually be the case. There's Mallory. Mallory is still here. I'm going to release him or her back onto Juma when we get to the carport where she came from. If it is a she, I shall give her the parting advice of... never mistake romance. Bye, Mallory. Have fun. Hey, I'll just keep my advice to myself then. Well, if you're a boy, watch out for the ladies. They'll really get you down. On that utterly bizarre note, having travelled all the way from Juma to Cheetah Plains and back again, Mallory, sensing home and freedom, took off and flew away. On that note, thank you to Jandre for his wonderful camera work, the rest of the Safari Live crew, and most importantly to all of you for bearing with that utter madness. I hope you had fun, and we'll see you on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Well, welcome back, and it has been a fun but slightly mad drive, well, from Jamie's part. I mean, we've had lots of fun, some lovely baby impala. It has been a bit quiet, could be something with the heat and the strong wind, but I was just chatting to Vim, and I was like, how can we work something you would never expect into a live safari? Well, Thundercats are a go, go, go. Now, can you believe it? In popular culture, just because it's International Cheetah Day, what was its name, Vim? Cheetara was one of the lead characters in the Thundercats. So obviously based on a cheetah, looking spotted like a cheetah and having a name like Cheetara. And the other one, oh, of course, Cheetos, the chip, by the Lay's Frito Company. It was, of course, based off a cheetah. So there we go. Cheetahs even affect us in popular modern culture. But from Vim and myself and the rest of our live crew, it's been wonderful. Hopefully, there's a cheetah or two and no Cheetos on the Sunset Safari.